Hello, I'm Carl Grossman. The move is on to zap our food. Food irradiation, the topic of this edition of Enviro CloseUp. For decades, the nuclear industry has sought to radiation-expose food, and the push is accelerating. Indeed, U.S. Agricultural Secretary Michael Espy is now calling for mandatory irradiation of meat. Food and Water Incorporated, and they're based in Marshfield, Vermont, is the main group in the United States fighting food irradiation. Michael Colby is the executive director of Food and Water. Michael, what is wrong with food irradiation?
Well, Carl, there are so many things wrong with food irradiation, it's difficult to know where to begin. The technology poses serious threats to workers, to the environment, and also it poses food safety problems. But first, I think it's important to understand where food irradiation came from. The food industry didn't ask for it, and consumers certainly didn't ask for it. In the 1950s, under the Atoms for Peace program, under President Eisenhower, there was a push to do something with the radioactive waste left over from building nuclear bombs. They started a program called the Byproducts Utilization Program, specifically to come up with uses for radioactive waste. One of the uses was to expose food to irradiation, to extend the shelf life and to kill bugs and insects and microorganisms on the food. And since that time, the 1950s, 40-some-odd years, the Department of Energy, the International Atomic Energy Agency, and what was the Atomic Energy Commission have been promoting food irradiation quite hard.
Now, how is food irradiation done? I mean, how does that food get zapped?
Well, food irradiation plants are basically small nuclear facilities. The amount of radioactive material in one of these plants is equivalent, for example, of what was released in Chernobyl. Millions, 3, 4, 5 million curies of radioactive isotopes. The isotopes are stored in huge pools of water, and the pools of water are in concrete rooms, 6-foot-thick concrete rooms, which of course keeps the radiation in those rooms and out of the neighborhoods where the plants are built. The food comes in to the chamber, the irradiation chamber, with the source down in the water. The doors are closed, and then the source comes up out of the water and exposes that food to radiation. How long that takes place is dependent on how much of a dose you want to give to the food. Usually it's somewhere between a half hour and an hour. The dose approved for fruits and vegetables is 100,000 rads, which is equivalent to 10 million chest x-rays. With meat, poultry, for example, the approved dose is 300,000 rads, which is the equivalent of 30 million chest x-rays. It's an enormous amount of energy going through those food products.
The advocates of food irradiation say, but the food isn't left irradiated. I mean, it is not hot with radioactivity.
No. If everything is done properly, the food does not become radioactive. There have been accidents where at these irradiation facilities, products have become radioactive. But that's not the issue that we're concerned about. We're concerned about what that amount of energy does to a food item. When you shoot 10 to 30 million chest x-rays through a food item, you are rearranging the molecular structure. You're shattering it, shuffling the whole makeup of that food item. Some of the chemicals that are formed after they're shattered were in the food product before, but there are a whole host of new chemicals that are brand new, unique to the food item, and have never been tested on a long-term basis to see what kind of impact they'll have on URI's health if we eat these new chemicals.
Now, there's been some studies indicating some kind of relationship between some of these products caused by food irradiation and cancer. Are those studies, in your judgment, in your group's judgment, sound?
Oh, absolutely. There are hundreds of studies that have been done on irradiated food. And in fact, the Food and Drug Administration has looked at the same studies that we have. In the 1960s, for example, they rescinded their original approval of irradiated strawberries and pork because they found carcinogenic properties in irradiated food. We know, for example, in meat, that benzene is created when you expose it to radioactive sources. Benzene is a very potent carcinogen. Likewise, formaldehyde has been known to be created in irradiated food. Certain peroxides, which are mutagens, are known to be created in irradiated food. And also, we know that you're depleting the nutritional quality of the food item, sometimes quite significantly. 60, 70, 80% of the essential nutrients can be zapped out of the product when it's irradiated.
In 1992, the Vindicator food irradiation plant, first food irradiation plant in the U.S., opened in Florida. Mm-hmm. It's still in operation.
Yes, it is. It's doing quite miserably, though. Since they opened up, they claimed in January of 1992 when they opened that they would have clients lined up, that they'd be operating three shifts per day, and it would be the best thing since sliced bread, if you will. Well, just the opposite has taken place. In the year and a half that they've been open, they've now lost over $2 million. Out of 38,000 markets in this country, two have sold irradiated food that's been labeled. They're both very small markets, one in Chicago called Carrot Top, and one in North Miami called Lorenzo's Market. And they just sold a few irradiated strawberries, a few irradiated grapefruit, some juice oranges, and I believe some Vidalia onions. And that's the extent of the irradiated food in the market today.
We'll be back with the topic of food irradiation and Enviro Close-Up right after this.
Save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
We're back with Michael Colby, the Executive Director of Food and Water, the main group in the United States which has been fighting food irradiation. Now, Michael, another Michael, Michael Espy, the U.S. Agricultural Secretary, has been calling for the mandatory irradiation of meat. That's in the wake of the E. coli poisoning out in the Northwest. He says it's necessary for health. What's your reaction?
Well, it's simply absurd. I think Secretary Espy panicked and in the face of the E. coli tragedy tried to grab anything possible to make it look like the administration was attempting to solve the problem. It's a backwards approach to this problem. We know where E. coli came from, much like we know where the salmonella problem in poultry came from. The facilities are filthy where they process these meat products. The speeds at these processing plants are enormously fast. Sometimes workers are seeing 90 birds per minute. At the same time that workers are seeing birds at this speed, inspectors, federal inspectors, are supposed to be making sure that the birds or the meat products are safe. It's just outrageous. It's an impossible task. As if that's not enough, during the last 10 years under Reagan and Bush, more than 700 meat inspectors have been cut, basically leaving the industry to police themselves. So what we're saying is we can solve these problems, these meat pathogen problems, through common sense. Clean up the facilities, slow down the processing, and put the inspectors back on the side of consumers. That solves the problem without relying on high-tech toxicological gimmicks that in fact create more problems than they solve. And it's interesting, the food industry, the meat industry, is agreeing with us on this point. Just recently in Meat and Poultry magazine, the July edition, the editors wrote that irradiation is, quote, the wrong hope, that they need to be focusing on the things that I just talked about, cleaning up their facilities, slowing down the speeds, and getting inspectors back on the side of consumers.
Let's get to the regulation of food irradiation. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration in the late 1980s approved irradiation for fruits, for vegetables, and then it went on to chicken. Mm-hmm. It's not done shellfish, and it's not done meat yet. Yeah. What are the, I mean, how does someone know if you go to a store, if you go to a market, that the food there is irradiated? How would you know if you go to a restaurant that you're eating or not eating irradiated food?
Well, with the case of a restaurant, you'll never know.
Really?
The Food and Drug Administration, when they approved irradiated food, said they also approved labeling requirements. And it's a radura, is what it's called. It's a flower symbol with a broken band around it. And it's, that flower symbol is supposed to be accompanied with the words, treated by irradiation. That's only for whole irradiated foods. For example, a whole chicken that is irradiated and sold as a whole chicken, a whole apple, a whole onion, etc. If any of those products are processed, say the chicken is irradiated and put in chicken soup, then there is absolutely no labeling requirements. Restaurant foods, absolutely no labeling requirements for any irradiated food served in restaurants or cafeterias or any processed foods. So there are loopholes with irradiation that you could drive a truck through. And our group has been trying to close those loopholes as much as possible. But we feel, even more importantly than that, is just to stop the construction of these facilities and stop irradiation outright.
Getting back to the FDA, because I think it's important. I mean, at least we should know whether food is irradiated or not irradiated. What was the dynamic there? Was it nuclear industry pressure on the FDA which caused this agency to allow for these loopholes?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question that the Department of Energy and the nuclear establishment has put enormous pressure on the FDA, because that's the only reason that scientists who've looked at the studies that the FDA showed as proof of safety would do something as ludicrous as they did. For example, when they approved the irradiation of fruits, vegetables, and spices, in the Federal Register, they pointed to five studies. Five studies, and they've been doing this technology for 40 years. And if they, after 40 years and tens of millions of dollars of research, they can look the American public in the eye and point to five studies demonstrating safety, there's something drastically wrong with the FDA. And I don't think there's any question that there is something drastically wrong with the FDA. What's worse is we've had epidemiologists, heads of medical schools, look at those five studies, and they are flawed. Animals were being born dead. We found out they were giving vitamin supplements to some of the animals that were being experimented on, an obvious attempt to correct problems that they foresaw through feeding animals with feeding irradiated food to animals. So there's no doubt that the FDA is a political body, and because they're a political body, they are subject to lobbying from their sister organizations.
We'll be back with Michael Colby on the issue of food irradiation on Enviro Close-Up right after this.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe, trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
You're lucky.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
Don't worry. The safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
alone can't save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Radiation exposed food. Michael Colby, the advocates of food irradiation point to other countries around the world and say, well, the United States should keep up with China, should keep up with South Africa, should keep up with Russia, and those countries do food irradiation. Why shouldn't we, they say?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a whole shell game going on internationally with irradiated food. In Europe, for example, consumers there are told that the United States people are eating this stuff up. They can't get enough of it on the shelves. Likewise here, we're told that France is eating it, and Japan is eating it, and other European countries are eating these products, and we're going to fall behind with another important technology. It's just not true. We've contacted the embassies, spoken to the departments of agriculture in the numerous countries, and we're finding out that the United States is really the leader in this technology, with the exception of the countries you mentioned, the Soviet Union, or what was the Soviet Union, South Africa and China. Those are really the world leaders in irradiated food. But I would submit that if we're following the technological or social policies of these countries, we're in serious trouble.
Because of the nature of those specific countries in terms, I suppose, of human rights and democracy. Yeah. There's a company in Canada, speaking of the international picture, it's called Nordion, which appears to be a major player in food irradiation. I mean, many of the plants, mostly then we're talking about medical irradiation plants around the world, and some food irradiation plants are provided with equipment by Nordion. What's Nordion's background? What's its interests?
Well, Nordion changed their name about 3 years ago. They used to be Atomic Energy of Canada Limited. They were very similar to our Department of Energy here in the United States. They're a crown corporation, kind of quasi-governmental body. Their interest is they basically have a monopoly on cobalt-60, which is one of the radioactive isotopes used in irradiators. They want to set up as many clients as they can across the world, because when they set up clients, help build facilities, they have an obvious a client for their cobalt-60, a place to sell their goods, so to speak. So they are a very key player. And for very obvious reasons, because they want to make a buck on their cobalt-60.
That Vindicator plant down in Florida, you had mentioned that earlier.
Yeah.
That, as I understand it, was equipped for operation by Nordion.
Oh, yeah. Nordion gave them some interest-free loans, gave them the technical plans, the drawing plans, so to speak, for the facility. And within the last year, two Nordion officials joined the board of directors of Vindicator. So there's a very close link between the supplier, Nordion, and the irradiation company Vindicator.
And where does Nordion get its cobalt-60?
Well, they mine cobalt-59 in Canada. It's a non-radioactive element. And then they put them in the CANDU reactors in Canada, bombard them, and make them radioactive cobalt-60. Then they store that in what they call the pencils, the rods where the cobalt-60 is put into, and then they ship those around the world to the irradiation facilities.
You spoke earlier about nuclear waste from the U.S. nuclear atomic nuclear facilities being used, at least the hope would be it would be used for food irradiation. That's not cobalt-60.
No, no. Cesium-137 is the waste product from building nuclear bombs, nuclear weapons. They, of course, that was the original push for food irradiation until there was a horrible accident in Decatur, Georgia, at a cesium-137 facility. That gave the DOE and their food irradiation program an enormous black eye, because after 30 years of promising that this was state-of-the-art, foolproof, no way these capsules could leak. Two of them did leak, contaminated products, made actual consumer products being radioactive, and they were shipped to the marketplace. 10 employees were exposed, and taxpayers had to come in and clean up this facility, and it cost state of Georgia and federal taxpayers over $40 million. So since that accident took place in 88, cesium-137 has kind of taken a back seat to this to the irradiation industry, to the radiation industry's push. But it's still there. They still have millions, tens of millions of curies of cesium-137 in Hanford, Washington. They'd love to unload, because it's quite simply their garbage. Anyone would like to make a dollar on their garbage. And there is not an enormous supply of cobalt-60 in the world right now. So if you see a huge push in irradiation, if poultry irradiation is accepted or by the American consumers, you're going to need hundreds of new facilities, and then we'll see cesium-137 come back into the picture.
The big question, what can people do about food irradiation? How can people fight it? That right after this.
Significant event in automotive history. It's coming. The end of the age of the automobile. Hope alone can't save our seas. Save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Like what can people do about radiation-exposed food? Michael Colby, Executive Director of Food and Water. What's there to be done?
Well, I think the most important thing is that people reject radiation-exposed foods in the marketplace. That's the best thing that can be done. It sends a very strong message to the industry, and it's the best place to win as a consumer movement. You know, we could beg for the policy crumbs that fell off Mike Gespy's desk or President Clinton's or Al Gore's desk. That really gets us nowhere. If we send a strong message in the marketplace that we will not tolerate these products, we'll boycott stores that sell these products, we can have a clear victory with irradiated food and then take the safe food movement onto other issues, pesticides, biotechnology, et cetera.
How would it work out? I mean, should you write a letter to the local supermarket and say?
Sure, everyone shops at a market. Go talk to your produce manager to start with. Ask him or her about the issue. Let him or her know that you're aware of this technology. You know that it poses dangers to the environment, to workers at these facilities, that it hasn't been proven safe, or that you know that carcinogens are created in the process, and that you will not tolerate these products in that store. You'll shop elsewhere if you see irradiated food in that market. Then talk to the manager of the entire store as well and do the same thing. You can also call Food and Water and get literature. We'd be happy to send literature to people, and you can pass that literature on to the produce manager or the manager of the supermarkets where you shop.
What about local political action? A number of states, in fact, have passed resolutions, have passed laws, which would prohibit food irradiation. I mean, this is in the absence of federal action. Yep. Do you recommend that?
Well, you're right. New York, Maine, and New Jersey have laws on the books not allowing the irradiation of food products. In fact, Governor Cuomo of New York just extended the ban there for another 2 years. Locally, it's much more feasible to get one of these pieces of legislation through. But again, we try to get people to focus on marketplace organizing. You don't have to compromise. You don't have to go to any hearings and get compromised in that whole process. It gives you a chance for a real clean, effective victory by organizing in the marketplace. And that's really what we've done. We've got every major supermarket, every major poultry company, every major produce company on record, based on the marketplace activism, saying they're not going to touch this technology. That's why the facility in Florida is going bankrupt, and that's why we want to keep the focus on those kind of efforts.
And that was supposed to be the first of, as I understood it, 1,000 food irradiation plants in the U.S., the Vindicator plan.
Yep. The DOE in the 1970s and 80s were envisioning thousands of plants. And you would need thousands of plants if you're going to treat all the poultry and all the beef and all the fruits and vegetables in this country. So you're right. That was supposed to be the first of 1,000. But if that's any indication of the way this technology is going to go, I think we're poised for a major victory as long as we keep the push on.
Getting back to what people can do, in terms of restaurants and in terms of cafeterias, I mean, you'll never know. I mean, what can you do in that situation?
Well, again, sound off to the restaurants, sound off to the cafeterias, and let people know you're not going to tolerate this technology at all. Again, it's easy at this point because there's just that one facility in Florida, and we're very focused on it. Food and Water monitors that facility. We've got people around who live near that facility who watch it practically 24 hours a day, so we know what kind of food's coming in and out. We will once in a while follow a truck to see where it's going, see if it's going to any other market than the two that are selling it. And then we let our network know when we find out which foods are coming out of it and where they're going.
Thank you, Michael Colby, for being with us in Enviro Close-Up. If viewers would like to get involved with your organization, Food and Water, where do they write? Who do they call?
Well, they can call toll-free number 1-800-EAT-SAFE, EATSAFE. Leave your name, address, and phone number, and you'll get a free information packet, a free copy of our newsletter, Safe Food News, and you'll be put on our Safe Food Network. So when we find out if irradiated foods are coming to an area near you, we'll let you know, and hopefully you'll take action to put an end to it.
Michael Colby, Executive Director of Food and Water, the anti-food irradiation group based in Vermont. I'm Carl Grossman. This is Enviro Close-Up, and thank you for watching.